Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center podcast. We hope that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a word from Pastor Dan Roth.
You know what? You didn't come today to church to hear from Pastor Dan, from Pastor Luke, from Pastor Jim, Pastor Deborah. Listen, doesn't matter who's in the pulpit. It's about us coming together and hearing from the Holy Spirit, preparing our hearts to hear from God. Doesn't matter, could be young or old, black, white, brown, any other color you could imagine, tall, short, thin. Listen, does not matter. What matters is that as we come together, we listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit. So today, let's prepare our hearts. I'm going to get down on my knees and pray. If you would, stand to your feet, and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you praise. God, it's so good to be in your presence, good to be in the house of the Lord. And God, we're excited about coming into the house of God today and hearing from you. Lord, as we open up your word, we pray that you open it up to us, open us up to receive it. May we have eyes that see, ears that hear, and hearts that have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. God, we thank you, Lord, that you're so wise and so awesome that you can speak an individual now word to each and every person who's hearing this message today, God. We're grateful, God, that today as we receive that word, God, that you give us vision, wisdom, instruction. Father God, even discipline and correction, Lord, you're a good God, and as a good father, you love your children enough to do that. And so we praise you and we thank you for that, God. Just strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you've called us to be and to do all that you've called us to do. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. And God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches that are preaching and teaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. Lord, they're our brothers and sisters. We love them. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building one kingdom that's yours. So God, we ask that you bless our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest and Oak Valley and Oasis, God, Inland Christian Center, God. We thank you, Father God, for our Adventist and our Catholic brothers and sisters. Bless them, Lord. All the churches that are preaching the gospel, Lord, we pray that you bless them as you bless us this day. Be among them as you would be among us this day. Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. You can have a seat. Well, I'm going to take a page out of Pastor Jim's book today. I don't know how long you can stare at this white coat. Thank you, chaplain. Praise God. Let's go to the Word of God, Hebrews, the 6th chapter. For those of you that are joining us for the first time, first of all, I'd like to welcome anybody who's here on the live stream from around the world, wherever you're at it, throughout the United States and all over the world. Thanks for joining us online. I know God's going to speak to you wherever you're at. And for those of you that are joining us for the first time, we go line upon line, precept upon precept through the Word of God. We believe that God wrote it that way. We ought to be able to understand it that way. See, when these letters, really, in the New Testament, when you read the epistles, these are letters to churches. When these were written, there was not chapter and verse like we have today, and it wasn't topical. It was the Spirit of God was moving in an area and was going through a system of thought and of understanding. And therefore, as we go line upon line, precept upon precept through the Word of God, we get that understanding and that flow of what the Holy Spirit is speaking to the church. Been in a series, this is the third part, and the title of the series is The Elementary Principles of Christ. You remember, let me just rewind your thinking a little bit, in Hebrews chapter 5, right at the end, and chapter 6, as we get into this, that even though the people should have been advanced and should have been mature and should have been teachers by now, that they had to go back to the basics. They had to go back to the milk of the Word, and now we find the elementary principles of Christ. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 through 3 describes them. Hebrews chapter 6, starting in verse number 1, says this. It says, therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God, of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. Now, remember, as we talked about maturity and we talked about the Word of God, that maturity in the Word of God is how we respond to life with the Word of God. And then if we're not responding to life with the Word of God, what are we responding to life with? Our own thoughts, our own ideas, with what educators say and what society says? Well, that's an immature approach to the things of God, and therefore we need to be taught again. The foundation needs to be laid, and we can't go on to maturity until we have these basics in our lives. In other words, we need to leave the discussion, but we need to live the principles. Are you hearing me today? And so just like a house, you can't start the framing, you can't start the electrical, you can't start the plumbing until that foundation has been laid and it's been signed off on. And so God is the one who's going to give us the permit, if you will, to go on to maturity. But we can't get there until we have these things in operation in our lives. Part number one, Pastor Jim did a great job talking about the foundation of repentance from dead works, faith towards God. Pastor Luke, last time we were together, talked about the doctrine of baptisms and of the laying on of hands. That was a great message last time. And if you didn't get a hold of those, they're online for free, or you can purchase them there at the CD counter. Today, we're going to talk about the last two, number five and number six. We're going to talk about the resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment. Let's start with number five for today, the resurrection of the dead. The Bible describes that there will be a bodily resurrection of the dead, both of the just and of the unjust. Everybody that has ever walked the face of the planet is an eternal being. It doesn't stop at death. That there will be a resurrection, and we will go on into eternity. Now, the just will go on to eternal life with God. The unjust will go on to eternal punishment in hell away from God. Now, we're going to see that in the Word of God as we go through the Scriptures today. You're going to see that. Okay? Now, the good news is that we have the choice while we're here on the earth of where we're going to spend eternity. That we can either choose that, hey, you know what? I'm going to go on to heaven. I'm going to be with God. Or we can choose to reject that, and by our life, we choose eternal punishment. It's our choice. And that's the good news. You say, why is that such good news? Because the good news is you don't have to go to hell. You can go be with Jesus. That when you're raised again, that you can go on forever in fellowship with God, in perfect communion with God. No more sin, no more pain, none of that anymore. Now you get a new resurrection body. Hello, come on, somebody. And now you get to be with Jesus. That's what this is all about. Turn with me to the book of John. You're there in Hebrews. Turn back to the Gospel of John. Let's take a look at the words of Jesus regarding the resurrection. John chapter number 11. Let me set the stage for you. Jesus has been in a certain place. He's been traveling, and word comes to him that one of his friends, they say, the one whom you love, is sick. And so he stops there, and he says, hey, you know what? This is for the glory of God. His friend ends up dying. His friend's name was Lazarus. They send word to him, and now he says, hey, you know what? It's time for us to go. So they go, and they head out there, and as Jesus is coming up to the place where they were, he is confronted by Lazarus' sister, Martha. And Martha says, Jesus, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And he says, you know what? If you can believe this, he's going to be raised again. And she says, well, I know at the last day in the resurrection of the dead, all of us will be raised up again. Now, very interesting how Jesus responds. Take a look at this with me. John chapter number 11. We're going to take a look at verse number 25 and verse number 26. John chapter 11, verse number 25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Verse number 26, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Now, that's a great question for us today. Do we believe this? When we take a look at the Word of God and when we see that there will be a resurrection of the dead, are we believing in Jesus for our salvation? Are we trusting in him for our eternal life? Because if we do, Jesus said, even though you may die, you're going to live forever. And whoever dies, doesn't matter, you're going to live on to be with him. My goodness, that's what this is all about. Because now we can go on to be with Jesus forever and ever. Next, number six, after the resurrection of the dead, is eternal judgment. See, these go hand in hand. There will be a resurrection of the dead, and all of the dead will stand before God, and we will give an account of our lives before God. And our lives and our works will be tested before him. Turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter number 25. You're there in the Gospel of John, a couple of Gospels back to Matthew, chapter number 25. And in Matthew chapter 25, we're going to read a lot of verses. I'm going to let you know this up front, okay? But it's okay because it reads like a story, and it's good stuff for us. Matthew chapter 25, we're going to start in verse number 31, and we're going to read through verse number 46. Matthew 25, verse 31, when you get there, say amen. Man, you guys are fast. Matthew 25, verse 31 says this. It says, when the Son of Man, Jesus speaking of himself, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Verse 32, all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them from one another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. Now notice, all the nations will be gathered before him. The only way that can happen is at the resurrection of the dead. that all the nations, because some nations have come and gone. Some nations were here one day, and then they were defeated, and now they're no longer a nation. So if all the nations are going to stand before the Lord, that means that we are talking about now the resurrection of the dead, and now this is the day of judgment. He will separate them as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. Verse 33, and he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Verse 34, then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. See, those that have trusted in Jesus, these are the blessed of the Father. Now they're going to come into and inherit the kingdom prepared for them from the foundation of the world. Verse 35, for I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? I think I would have remembered that. Verse 38, when did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? I mean, if I saw Jesus walking around naked, I would have known it, and I would have remembered that. A little bit weird, a little bit different, and I would have logged that one in my memory banks. And yet they don't remember it, but look at what Jesus says. Verse 40, and the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Or in other words, your life was committed to Jesus Christ. You trusted him for your salvation, and now your works that flowed out of you, yes, they were done to people, but they were done unto the Lord. Wow. That's pretty awesome. But verse 41 comes along. Look at this. Then he will say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Now stop right there for a second. Anybody who says that there is no hell does not believe what the Bible says. You just read it in your Bible, in your lap. You see it up there on the overheads, that there is a place of eternal punishment. It's a place that no one wants to go to. It's a place of torment for eternity, everlasting fire. So there is a burning. I'm not just preaching hellfire and brimstone just because that's popular or because I want to scare people away. This is Bible. This is what the Bible says. See, there are churches who think that you can't handle this, that you can't understand it and comprehend it, so they keep this from you because they want to just keep you coming and just keep you in a certain mind frame so that you'll just continue to come in that religious experience. That's not what this is about. There are other churches that will not say these things to you because they think that they will offend you and scare you off. So rather than tell you the truth, they will water it down and sugarcoat it and spoon feed you little bits here and there in order to make sure that you keep coming. Not so in this church. In this church, we will declare to you the truth of the living Word of God. You're able to handle it. You're smart enough and you're strong enough. And even though it rubs you the wrong way and we don't like it, hey, it's good. It's healthy. It's strong. And we need to know the truth. That's what this is about. And I want you to notice something about hell. Hell was never intended for us. Hell was never made for humanity. How do I know that? Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for you? Oh, wait. Prepared for you? Who is it prepared for? Prepared for the devil and his angels. See, God didn't intend for people to go to hell. God is not mean-spirited. God is not cruel. God is just. God is loving and God is kind. But because God is just, he cannot deny himself. And this fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels, we choose with our lives, and God is so just and so loving that he allows us that choice. So he says, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for his angels and the devil. Verse 42, for I was hungry and you gave me no food. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not take me in. Naked and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit me. Now look at the response. Verse 44, they will also answer him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? They have the same response as the righteous. They still call him Lord, and yet there's something lacking in their lives. Let's look at it. Verse 45, then he will answer them saying, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to the one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. In other words, they neglected the things of God. They neglected Jesus, and therefore with their life they chose their path for eternity. Verse 46, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Now, the Bible tells us that we are to have assurance, that we are to have boldness, that we can have confidence on the day of judgment. Why? Because if we believe in Jesus for our salvation and we live his ways, then we have no fear. Why? Because we know, hey, I'm one of the sheep. I'm going to the right side. I'm not going to the left side. I'm going to the right side. I'm going on into the joy of the Lord. I'm going on into eternal, righteous life. That's where I'm going. I'm headed for heaven. And that's a good thing. We can have that boldness. We can have that confidence as we put our life in him. Now, today, I didn't want to just give you information without giving you an application and an inspiration along with that of what does this mean to our lives? See, one thing to know about this, everybody knows about this. We all know about heaven and hell from a young age. We see cartoons where, you know, people dig down and they find the devil and stuff like that, and they're getting poked in the rear with a pitchfork and stuff like that. And we always understand, and when they die, they go up with the harps and things like that. And so at a very young age, we are introduced to the reality of heaven and hell. We're also understanding of the fact that we're going to go before God. But it's one thing to know about that, but yet quite a different thing to live our life in a way that should respond to the information that we know. Are you listening? So today, what does the resurrection and eternal judgment mean to me? Ah, I'm glad you asked. A couple of things we're going to take a look at today quickly. A couple of things. What does the resurrection and eternal judgment mean to me? Number one, it means keep an eternal perspective. Keep an eternal perspective. We have to picture the fact that we are eternal beings and not get so caught up in the day-to-day, mundane, right now, this is all there is, and there's nothing else. We've got to keep that picture in our minds. You know, I love pictures. I'm an artistic type of a guy. I love photography. And so oftentimes, you know, I'll bother my wife because I'm looking at picture sites. You know, there's a lot of websites right now out there, photo sharing, and the big thing is people with their phones. Actually, during praise and worship, I saw people taking pictures, sharing it probably on the internet with their friends. This is my church. Look how cool it is, all that kind of stuff. And they're, you know, hashtag rock church or something like that. And so, you know, that's a really popular thing. In fact, even before my wife and I took our last vacation this last summer, we were getting ready, and I wanted to go see Yosemite. So this year, it was my vacation. I told my wife, I said, honey, you get next year. I get this year, though. I want to go to Yosemite. I want to go see the valley. I want to go and experience Yosemite. I've never been there in my life. And I know it's a long drive and all that kind of stuff, but hey, it's cool. We'll put on some movies in the minivan for the kids. We'll leave early. We'll be all right, you know? And so she agreed to that. But leading up to our vacation, I drove her nuts. She would find me curled up on the side of our bed with my iPad, looking at pictures online of Yosemite. A lot worse things you could be looking at online in the middle of the night, but I was looking at our nation's national parks. In fact, I downloaded apps on my phone so that I could look at pictures of Yosemite. And I had everything all planned out. I wanted to go to Valley View. I wanted to go to Tunnel View. I wanted to go and get my Ansel Adams on, you know. I have the camera set up, and I wanted to take that shot right there, you know. I wanted to just have it all laid out in front of me, the valley, and there's Half Dome. There's El Capitan. I wanted Bridalveil Falls. I wanted it all right there in front of me. I wanted to go up, and I wanted to experience Glacier Point. And so I was looking at everybody's pictures of Glacier Point and how they caught the clouds and the light of the sun setting and hitting off Half Dome and all this kind of stuff. And so I just kind of nerded out, if you will, and just went after it. And I got a picture in my mind. Are you listening? I got a picture in my mind of what was coming up. And then when I got there, I was like a kid in a candy shop. I told my wife, I said, just get ready. I'm going to drive you crazy. We are going to stop at random places on the road. I'm going to set up my camera. I'm going to take pictures. Just know that it's coming. She said, all right, we'll let you do your thing, you know. And so I did promise her I will not exhaust you. We'll just pick a couple of things, and we'll go do that. And I had everything planned out. I had it all. Every day there was something. This day we're going to go do this. This day we're going to go do that. This day is going to be the giant sequoias and all that kind of stuff. And I had pictures of all of that. See, the Bible, when we look forward to the future, and keeping an eternal perspective gives us pictures of what's to come. The Bible shows us pictures. In fact, if the Bible had a Facebook site, we would probably go and like the pictures that were on there. You know what I'm saying? Because God gives us pictures. Turn to the book of Revelation. Let's take a look at one of them. Revelation chapter number 20. Revelation chapter 20, kind of towards the back of your Bible. You hit the maps, turn around and come back. Revelation chapter 20. Verse number 12, we're going to start. Revelation chapter number 20, verse number 12, gives us a picture of what's to come. We see the great white throne of judgment, the resurrection of the dead, and now they're standing at the judgment. Look at what he says, Revelation chapter 20, verse 12. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God. And books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. Verse 13, the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Now, oftentimes we read a moment like this, something that is coming, and there's that fearful expectation because we say, I don't know, you know, my life, it doesn't seem to value that much. All I do is make money. All I do is go to work. I wake up in the morning, I eat, I go to work, then I make the money so that I can buy the food, so that I can eat at night, so that I can go to bed, so that I can wake up in the morning and go to work, make the money so that I can eat, so that I can go to bed, so that I can wake up. And it's this cycle of just boring, cycle of just monotony, cycle of just no purpose, no value. And we say, you know what? The situations in my life are dead or dying. You know, I've got the pink slip. The kids have gone south. The marriage is over. You know, Pastor, things have stopped in my life. I'm not on that road to blessing. I'm not in that place. And when I read something like that, I get discouraged. And yet, church, the Bible says keep an eternal perspective. Why? Because God is a God of the living and not of the dead. Dead situations are still under the divine control. It's not over till God says it's over. And you take that situation, and you know what, that dead situation, that dead marriage, those dead kids, that dead paycheck, the dead bills, whatever it is, and you place it in the hands of the Master, and now God touches it, and God resurrects it, and God says, this is my judgment on it, this is what I say about it, and this is how it's going to be. Take your life, take your work. See, sometimes we think of work as this is just work, this is just making money. And yeah, that is pointless. Yeah, money's going to burn. It's just a world system that's going to stop. And yet, when you take your work and you take your money and you put it into the hands of God, and now all of a sudden you say, God, I'm going to work as unto the Lord. My job is not just my job for my employer. No, now I'm working for Jesus. And whatever they ask me to do, doesn't matter if I was hired to be an engineer, if they ask me to go pick daisies for 8 hours, I'm going to go pick daisies to the glory of God. All of a sudden, God takes your work, and now it becomes something eternal as you build the kingdom of God with your life. Are you listening today? God is God of the living. Keep that eternal perspective. Keep those pictures in your mind. Make sure to put it ever before you so that when you get there, you can rejoice. What does the resurrection and eternal life, eternal judgment mean to me? Number one, it means keep an eternal perspective. Second thing it means is keep a clear conscience. Keep a clear conscience. Bible tells us at the end of 2 Peter that everything on the day of the Lord's return, that there will be a trumpet sound, there will be fervent heat, everything is going to be dissolved in that fervent heat, consumed by the fire. And Peter asks the questions to his readers. He says, because everything's going to be dissolved in this matter, what sort of people should you be? And you know what? He answered his own question. He goes on to say, in holy conduct and godly living. What does that mean? That means that we've got to watch our life. Yes, the Lord has saved us. Yes, all of our sin is under the blood. Yes, we are now by grace empowered to live life, but we have to watch our lives. We have to keep ourselves, the Bible says, in the love of God. Keep ourselves pure. Keep yourself unspotted from the world. See, we've got to live a life that is above reproach in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation among whom we shine as stars in the universe. Keep a clear conscience. You're there in Revelation, hold your finger there or keep a pencil or some sort of a marker there in Revelation. Turn me to the book of Acts. Right after the Gospels, you find the book of Acts. And Acts, we're going to go to Acts chapter number 24. Acts chapter number 24, the Apostle Paul is standing before governors and kings. And as he's standing there, he's giving a defense and talking about his life. Talking about why he does what he does, his purpose. And in Acts chapter number 24, we're going to start in verse number 15 and read through verse number 16. Take a look at it with me. Acts chapter 24, verse 15. Apostle Paul is speaking. He says this. He says, I have hope in God, which they themselves also accept, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and of the unjust. See, right there, he's talking about what we're talking about, the resurrection. Now, take a look at the next verse, verse number 16. This being so, in other words, because I know that it's not over until God says it's over, because I know that at the end of this life, I'm not done, that there's an eternity awaiting me, this being so, I myself always strive to have a conscience without offense toward God and men. See, it's not just about us saying, okay, my conscience is clear before God. Jesus has washed away my sins. I've confessed my sin to him. You know, when I get in trouble, I repent and I go back to God, that sort of a thing. That's great, and that'll get you into heaven. That's wonderful. But what if you stood there on the day of judgment and you said, God, my conscience is clear before you? And he says, yeah, but you didn't take care of the people around you. Oh, my goodness. See, the Apostle Paul says, I strive to keep my conscience clear before God, yes, but also before men. Why? Because we live in this life, and we have relationships, and there are people that we are doing life with. And God says, I want you to keep a clear conscience, yes, before me. Keep yourself in the love of God. Keep yourself unspotted. But also, I want you to have a good rapport with those who are outside the church, and I want you to really love the people inside the church. We say, but God, they're people. They're crazy. Do you know what they did to me, God? God says, yeah, do you know what they did to me? Oh, my. God, I'm having trouble forgiving. God says, I forgave you. You need to forgive as I also forgave you in Christ Jesus. Got to have a conscience clear before God, yes, but also before man. See, sometimes that means saying, I'm sorry. Sometimes that means saying, please forgive me. Sometimes that means going to the person who wronged you and who you didn't think you were wrong, but you still apologize even though you were right, and you say sorry that you offended them and sorry, and you apologize and ask for forgiveness when you're the one who needs to be forgiving. You understand what I'm saying? See, God expects more of us as Christians. And God says, you may not have been wrong, you may be right, but go humble yourself before that person and keep a clear conscience before them. Go and make amends. Go and bear that burden. Go and love them. Go and forgive them as God in Christ forgave you. Got to get a picture of this. Why? Because it's so important that we keep an eternal perspective and that we keep a clear conscience. Why? Because there is a resurrection of the dead. Why? Because there is an eternal judgment. What does the resurrection and eternal judgment mean to me? Last thing for today is keep your eye on the prize. Keep your eye on the prize. See, it's one thing to have a temporary view, one thing to have a now view, quite another thing to have that eternal perspective. And when you keep your conscience clear before God and before man, there is a reward that comes to the faithful. In fact, if you read throughout the Gospels, you read Jesus speaking in different parables where he talks about a king. And that king delivered his goods to his servants. And then that king went on a long journey, quite a distance away. And when the king returns and he calls his servants to account, speaking of the day of judgment, and now those servants come before the king, the ones who were faithful and the ones who kept a clear conscience and the ones who didn't mistreat others and the ones who took his goods and did something with it, those are the ones that the king commends. Those are the ones that the king rewards. And those are the ones to whom the king says, enter into the joy of your Lord. And as Christians, it is our goal, it is our aim to please the king so that when we go before the Lord on the day of judgment, we don't hear, away from me, you cursed. No, we hear, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your Lord. That's what this is about. Still got your finger there in Revelation? Revelation chapter 22 this time. Revelation chapter 22, another picture that God gives us of what we have to look forward to. Revelation chapter 22, verse number 12. Revelation chapter 22, verse 12 says this. It says, and behold, what does that mean? Look and see. Take a look at this picture. I'm putting it out there for you. Revelation 22, 12. Behold, I am coming quickly. Jesus is coming, church. That ought to excite us. We ought to be ready. We ought to be prepared. We ought to be hastening that day. I'm coming quickly, and my reward, my reward, my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. See, Jesus is talking about the church. Jesus is coming quickly, and his reward is with him. There are rewards that are coming to the faithful church. Stay faithful, stay focused, stay with Jesus. Keep that eternal perspective. Keep your conscience clear before God and before man. And the Bible says that he's coming quickly and his reward is with him. There is a reward that's coming to us, church. His name is Jesus. Come on, let's praise the Lord today if you got something from the Word of God. Woo! Hallelujah. What did we learn today? Three things that we learned. What does the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment mean to me? Number one, keep an eternal perspective. Keep your eyes on the prize. Number two, keep a clear conscience. Last thing, keep your eye on the prize. If you got something for the Lord, come on, give God a great big praise today. Hallelujah. I just want to thank you for allowing me to speak that word to you. I really do believe that you got something from the word of the Lord today. It was exciting. It was alive. And I really do believe that you got something from God. But it'd be a tragedy if we talked about the resurrection of the dead, and we talked about eternal judgment, and then we let you go, and your heart wasn't right with God, you died and went to hell. That'd be a tragedy. I don't want that. You don't want that. Most of all, we know God doesn't want that. So come on, today let's talk. I want to ask you a question. I want you to answer the question in your heart. No one knows the answer but you and God. Just take a moment quietly. Put out all other distractions. Don't worry about what the ushers are doing. Don't worry about what the people around you are doing. Turn off your cell phone. Put the notes away. Come on. Focus in on what God has to speak to you right now. Here's the question. Just answer it in your heart. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Just answer that question in your heart. I don't think anybody in here wants to go to hell. Yeah, I want to go to eternal punishment. That'd be foolish. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Now let's examine your answer, because it tells a lot about where you're at with God. Some of you might have said, well, Pastor, what makes me think I'm going to heaven? All roads lead to heaven. You have your truth. I have my truth. As long as we live to what we believe on our own, we'll all get there somehow. You know, these people have their way. They have their way. You have your way. I'll get to heaven my way. We'll all meet each other up there in the sky, because God is good and God is love, and he's going to let everybody into heaven. Well, we saw that that's not true from the Word of God. There are people that will be divided. Some will go to eternal life and reward. Others will go to eternal punishment. I want to make sure that's not you. Because, see, Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That means that it's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. It's not about everybody has their own way and you just do your thing and make sure that you're true to that. And God says, oh, they were true to themselves, therefore I'm going to let it. No, it doesn't work like that. There's a specific way. And don't you think God, creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who speaks and planets exist, the one who wrote the plan of redemption before the fall and before the foundation of the world, don't you think that if God went through all that beaten, bloody mess, hung on a cross in the form of his son Jesus, don't you think that if he went through all that, that he would tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word. Now, sometimes people hear that and say, yeah, I get that. That's good news, because you know what? I've been a good person. You know, I used to be bad, yeah, but I've done more good than bad. I've cleaned up my act, helped people out, gave money to charities, been nice to my neighbors. And I think I've been good enough that God will let me into heaven. Because God lets good people into heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say, be this good, you get to go to heaven? There's no grading scale, no curve, no line that you have to be above, no quota of good works that you have to do, this amount of good works, and that gets you into heaven. It doesn't work like that. And I love you enough today to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it just by being good. Your good works will not get you into heaven. In fact, the Bible records that our good works compared to God's good works, God's goodness, are like filthy rags to God. They're going to get thrown out. The standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Not going to get to heaven just by being good. I love you enough, respect you enough today, to honor you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. Some of you said, well, wait a second, Pastor. Not only have I been good, but I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Took me to religious classes like Sunday school, Sabbath school, catechism class. They hung a cross or a St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child. You're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, denying hell, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere? Check it out. Nowhere. Nowhere in the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible to say that you attend religious classes, be raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian, that makes you Christian. Nowhere in the Bible to say wear religious jewelry, be baptized or Christian as a child, or be born in America. Listen, I don't care how American you are, if you eat apple pie and drive a Chevrolet, nowhere in the Bible does it say that's going to get you in heaven. And again, nowhere do we see in the Bible that it says that because you're not some other religion, that by default God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. It doesn't work like that. You say, but Pastor, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. That's great. I'm glad you're here today. But you know that nowhere in the Bible says sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? That's like saying I could go down to Dodger Stadium in Los Angeles. I could wear the Dodger uniform, bring a bat and a ball, sit in the dugout, and think that I'm going to get to play in a game because I call myself a Dodger. You know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a part of the Dodgers organization. In the same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. You say, but hold on a second, Pastor. I get that, but in my last church, I got involved. I sang in the choir for a number of years. I helped out. I carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I taught in the Bible class. I even got a membership card to that church. It's great. I'm glad you did those things, but just show that to me in the Bible. Could you, where your church involved and gets you into heaven, where you help out, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader, teaching the Bible classes, and that gets you into heaven. It's not there. It doesn't work like that. And again, I don't see anywhere in the Bible that before you can enter the gates of heaven, God wants to see your membership card to a church. Come on, let's talk today. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, but hold on a second. I know God. Somebody told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. I know about Easter and the resurrection. Sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Old and New Testament. It's great. I'm glad you can do those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, could you? We're having head knowledge about who Jesus is. Knowing who God is. Listen, everybody in America knows who God is. The unjust we saw at the resurrection knew who God was, called him Lord. And yet that didn't make them Christians headed for heaven. Listen, doesn't matter. If you celebrate a holiday, sing some songs, or can quote scripture, you read your Bible, you know the demons believe Jesus Christ, Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and is recorded as quoting scriptures in the Bible. And yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Everybody look up at me for a second. It's not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, having head knowledge about who Jesus is. And that gets you right with God, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus came to a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. Now let me tell you about Nicodemus for a second. Nicodemus was a good guy. Did good things. He was a religious leader of his day, raised up in his church called the synagogue. He actually became the leader of the synagogue. He held to the strictest form of the law. We would have said if anybody was doing good works, it would have been this guy, Nicodemus. He could quote the scripture. He could sing the scripture. He could debate the scripture. He gave his money. People looked to him to find out about God. He was a teacher in Israel and taught people about God. We would have thought Jesus would have come to this guy and said, Nick, man, hey, you're doing a great job. Pat you on the back. You just keep doing what you're doing. I'll see you in heaven. He doesn't say that at all. Rather, what does he say? He says, you want to enter the kingdom of heaven? You must be born again. Now, I know a lot of people turn off at this point. They say, oh, being born again, I heard about that. Saw that on television. Read that in a book. It was weird. It was crazy. I don't want to have any part of that. But listen, being born again is not about what society and Hollywood and pop culture and music and television and books say or the internet says it is, but rather it's about what the Bible says. What does being born again mean from the Bible? Well, it's always meant the same thing. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's that simple. All or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Book of Revelation, last book of the Bible. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, I'm coming quickly. We saw that. He's coming. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Those are graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what is he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out. A little up, little down. A little token prayer every now and then. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus Christ, you need to look out. Why? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. God is saying, in or out, you can't be half-hearted riding the fence and make it. So today I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. I'm going to pop my hands together when I say three, just like this. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to be born again. I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. Be headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can go right back down. Now, you might be thinking at this point, whoa, wait. Time out. Did you just say what I think you said? You're going to point at my hand and count? I'll be embarrassed. A lot of people here today, they'll see me. I came with people who think I'm a Christian. They'll see me do that. Uh-huh. That might happen. That's okay. Think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? And ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Listen, no one would make that trade. Yet the devil's trying to push you. Your flesh is trying to keep you back. You got to push past all that today. Say, it doesn't matter if I'm embarrassed. Probably won't even be, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. And listen, everybody around you wants this to take place. They're excited for you. We all did this at one time or another in one way or another. Today, come on, you can get right with God in a safe, friendly place. Now, who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this? Never given God all your heart, never given God all your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Come on, you can make a right relationship with God today in this safe and friendly church service. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or even online, wherever you're at all around the world, you can raise your hand. God is watching, then click the blue button right afterwards. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Get ready to get your hands up if that's you today. Here we go, all together on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Raise them up high. Thank you. There's one. There's two. God bless you. Who else today? There's three. Got you up there. There's got you already there. Thank you. You can put your hand down. There's three wise people already. Three wise people already. Come on. There's four back in the family room. Who else today? Anybody else real quick? There's five right there. I got you. Thank you. Five wise people already. Come on. You know you need to give God all your heart. You know you need to give. Thank you. Six up on top. I got you. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? If I haven't got you already, just wave it at me. Just wave it at me if that's you. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Thank you. Thank you. Got you right over here. About six or seven. Are those hands up in that family room? Thank you. Thank you. Got you up there. Thank you so much. About seven or eight wise people. Eight. Thank you. God bless you. Where are you at? Where are you at? Anybody else real quick? Just pop it up. Listen, I'm not selling knives at the county fair. Talking about your eternal life. Today we looked at the resurrection of the dead. We're eternal beings. And we looked at the judgment seat. And I want to make sure, I just want to take another moment. I want you to search your heart. What makes you think you're going to heaven? If it's not based on the fact that you're born again, then you need to do this. You say, Pastor, but you're pushing me. I'm uncomfortable. Yeah, listen, the devil's trying to push you into hell. I'm loving you enough to push you towards heaven. But you got to make the choice. I can't do it for you. Your neighbor can't do it for you. Listen, you've got to respond to God right now. Holy Spirit's tugging at your heartstrings. And if you know that's you, you know you need to do this. I'm going to give one last call. I'm going to look through the audience. Then I'm going to close this up. Don't miss this opportunity. You've missed enough opportunities in your life. Come on, do you need to give God all your heart and all of your life? Last call on this section. If that's you, pop it up and wave it at me when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else real quick? Got you up there in the family room. Thank you. Who else? No, you need to give God all your heart and all of your life. Anybody else? Real quick. Come on. Come on. We're waiting on you. You feel the Holy Spirit's tugging at your heart right now. Just respond to God and let your hand go up. Who else today? That's you. Come on. Come on. You're not alone. About eight or nine wise people. Come on. That's you. Go for it. Thank you up there. Gotcha. Gotcha. About 10 wise people. Listen. Lord just spoke to me. We're at 10. There are 24 of you total that need to get right with God. That's more than double. Yet you're allowing something, probably fear, to keep you back. Listen, this is a safe and friendly place. We love you. No one's judging you. No one's criticizing you. No one's condemning you. We're excited for you. So here's what I want to do. In a moment, we're all going to stand. We're going to give a clap and a shout because we're excited. Excited for you 10 that responded. But hey, the other 14 of you need to respond. Here's what we're going to do. In a moment, we're going to stand. We're going to give a clap and a shout. No one's going to leave during this time because that's rude. We're trying to get people to come this way. You're going that way. They're going to follow you out. Okay? So if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. In a moment, when we all stand and clap, Elijah's going to lead us in a song. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. Get all your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. If your children raise their hand, you're there in the family, your child raised their hand, they want to respond to God, that's okay. They're welcome to do that, and you can bring them too. They will remember this. And once you get your stuff, get a friend if you need a friend, get in the aisle and meet me up front. Now, very important, the 14 of you that didn't raise your hand, but you know God's tugging at your heart. Hey, you're welcome. There's no shame. You can just get your stuff and you can come too. So let's all stand and welcome them. You raise your hand or you should have raised your hand. You come right now. Get your stuff. Get in the aisle. Meet me up front. Come on. Come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I believe.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Jesus, I belong.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Come on, come on, come on. From the family, let's bring your children right now. Come on, come on down.
Jesus, I belong to you.
Come on, ushers, let's help the people. If you need to come, nudge your neighbor, say, friend, I'll go with you. Let's do this. Let's go on for God. Come on, come on. You can come too. You can come too. You can come too. Come on. They're still coming. Let's give them a hand. Let's give them a hand. Hallelujah. All right. Hey, thank God you guys have come. Very excited for you. Listen, this is not a bad thing. This is a good thing. You're not going on to punishment. You're going on to eternal life. You get to be with Jesus forever. You can put a smile on your face, okay? I want you guys to look over here to my right, your left. See the guy in the blue coat waving at you? This is Pastor Joel, all right? Pastor Joel is a really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, this guy up here, he's about as weird as he's going to get today. He's cool, all right? He's going to do three things. I'll let you know what they are in advance so that you're not wondering or scared or anything like that. Number one thing he's going to do is lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again, all right? Second thing he's going to do is going to give you some free stuff. Everybody loves free stuff. We love giving away free stuff, so we already have a good relationship, okay? He's going to give you a little book that our pastors wrote called Welcome to Your Destiny, Easy Steps to a Successful Future with God. Basically, it'll help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God. You need to get a hold of that. Invest, you know, 20, 30 minutes if you read it slow, and find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now, the final thing he's going to do is he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church that we like to call a spiritual personal trainer. You heard of a physical trainer at the gym, helps you get strong, helps you get it buff, kind of like me? Why are you guys laughing? Spiritual personal trainer will do that for you spiritually. Come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you one thing out of the Bible a week. So at the end, you'll learn five things that'll help you to get strong and healthy in the ways of the Lord. It's easy. It's free. You need to do it. Now listen, I'm going to make a promise to you guys. Give us 1 year of your life staying under the Word of God here at the Rock Church. Okay? Give us a year. At the end of that year and for the rest of your life, God will give that back to you. And you'll be so blessed that you'll say, wow, I didn't know it could be like this. Am I telling the truth, everyone? Hallelujah. So if you guys make left turn, follow Pastor Joel. Love you, Pastor Joel. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.